So much going on in that story. Glad he read the third part, or it'd be a pretty weird one for Mother's Day, wouldn't it? A woman whose soul is just broken, waiting for a child. So keep those Bibles open. We're going to be like a Mother's Day Bible study, a little bit head, a lot of it heart. Our scripture today is so powerful, we're going to respond in two ways. One, what do you do when you feel desperate? When you are Hannah, whether your crisis is with motherhood or depression or health or whatever, what do you do? And second, what do you do when someone else feels desperate? What do you do when you are in the place of Elkanah or Eli and someone in your life is in agony over their own crisis? How can you be a better supporter than those guys? So first of all, what did Hannah do when she felt desperate? I see five things. You get to follow along, and when you see a sixth thing after church, you tell me and help me understand this a little bit better from a woman's perspective. Verse 8, and Hannah and Elkanah said to her, and then there's a whole bunch of questions there. She talked to her husband. She reached out to someone who loved her, or she allowed someone who loved her to reach out to her. Step one in God's good news of what to do when you're desperate. Verse 10, she prayed to the Lord and wept bitterly. She asked God for help. Sometimes prayer is just organized yelling. Sometimes prayer is just disorganized wonder. However it fits for her there, she's asking, God, where are you? Step 3, verse 15. But Hannah answered to Eli. She talked to a priest. She reached out to someone in a position to help, or at least she allowed someone who could help to reach out to her. Verse 18, she ate and her countenance was no longer sad. While she's still hoping so desperately to be a mother and doesn't have a ton of hope on that, all these actions, and adding some food, add this sliver of hope that maybe she'll feel better. The way it's described, some translations just say she's sad no longer, which seems a little, I don't know, unrealistic to me to go from just the pit of despair to, oh, okay, everything's fine so quickly. I don't think we can expect that. It's never worked for me, but I do think she tries in here to face her emotions as best she can. Or maybe, I don't want to rewrite the Bible because I hate being misquoted, and that's probably why God says if anyone rewrites the Bible, they're going to burn. But at least, I think we can say, at the very least, that this sentence implies that Hannah does not give in to her worst feelings. She doesn't get trapped in that cycle of despair. 5, verse 19, she goes back home and, quote, Elkanah knew Hannah. Your Bibles try to clean that up a lot, but I would recommend scratching out the word new in there. So in those days, there's only two ways to have a child. In these days, there's really only two ways to have a child. One's with fancy technology, and one is a different word than new, and that's the same case back in those days. They didn't have fancy technology, so whatever your word is for new, that's the word that belongs in here. So she and Elkanah kept trying to have a baby. That's what she did. She kept trying, which is another response to despair, to keep going and not give in. That's five things. Talk to someone who loves you. Talk to the God who loves you. Try hard not to give in to your worst feelings. Talk to someone who can try to help and keep doing something, anything. Now, in Hannah's situation, in her culture, there was a ton of pressure around being a mother, or more so, about producing a child. Women in that culture, if you could not produce a child, you didn't matter, period. In fact, it was very common in the ancient Near East that if a woman could not have a child, even if it was the man's fault, he could divorce her. No questions, no process, no alimony, no support. If she couldn't have a child, she was on the street. So if you ever cringe when you have read Jesus telling folks that there are no grounds for divorce except infidelity, and some people get so up in arms about that now, and they shame women who've been divorced, and they invent some nonsense about traditional marriage that wasn't true in the 1950s, and it definitely wasn't true in the Bible, what Jesus was doing when he said that was protecting women from the dangerous cultural norms that devalued them and made it so easy for men to throw them away. Sounds harsh to our ears. It was incredibly graceful in his time, because it was totally unremarkable in his time or in Hannah's time for a man to have a dozen divorces for all sorts of reasons. And many of those women not only feared for their safety or had to resort to begging or selling themselves, but in the marriage they faced such pressure from their culture, from their other women, from their husbands, to have children or else they don't matter. That's Hannah's culture. Now, in our culture, I hope we've progressed some, but women, have you ever pressure by a person or by society, just a sense in the air that all your worth comes from your womb. I know in our culture, plenty of women, regardless of what someone else says, many women really, really want or need a child. It becomes part of an identity, a meaning, a fulfillment. Some of you have experienced that in difficult ways. Some of you have given thanks for the blessing of children as though that has made you whole or gives you meaning. I don't know, you can put whatever language on it you want. But in our culture, alongside any pressure that might come from outside, there is often an idea or some word, I don't know the word for the deep feeling of needing motherhood, that feeling of having children is such a personal thing, powerful, painful. Do you think Hannah felt that too? Do you think Hannah felt both pressure from outside and pressure from inside? In her culture, other than childlessness, people were stigmatized for being poor, having a disability, being from a foreign country, having certain sicknesses, being gay, having a different religion, and so many other things. As opposed to in our culture, where people are stigmatized for being poor, having a disability, being from a foreign country, having certain sicknesses, being gay, having a different religion, and so many other things. It's funny, we get all this technology and progress, and the world has changed in so many ways, but the things that hurt us, the list doesn't change, does it? And maybe this is just my premise, how I'm taking Hannah's particular story and trying to make it alive for all of our stories. Maybe what you can do when you feel desperate in all those sorts of ways, maybe that list doesn't change that much either. So however you are being attacked from the outside or struggling with your inner demons, talk with someone you love. Even if they aren't helpful today, God has given love in this world, not just for joy, but for healing as well. And whether you believe in God or prayer, or just want to yell at the universe, or sit in silence, or feel the breeze through the trees, those seem like such positive ways to respond to despair. At least better than yelling at people and drinking your sorrows away, which I've tried, you've tried, and don't get me wrong, it kind of helps in the moment maybe, but it's like when it's really cold outside and you just pee your pants, it feels great for a couple seconds, but it doesn't really solve anything. Third, whatever the cause of your desperation, talk to someone who can help, a therapist, a police officer, your boss, an AA partner, whoever. They might not know your suffering, and they can give you mercy when they do. They might know your suffering better than you do and give you some support. Or they might just have a resource you need. Maybe they can just listen. And if, like Hannah, even the waves of negativity keep coming, don't give in. It is rare that I've ever been able to go from crying on my knees to sad no more in an instant, but at my best, being ready for a good word. I put on uplifting music. I watch for something beautiful, or some of the birds you mentioned. Leaving the door open for light to shine in the darkness has been the room that God uses to build me back up. And finally, when I absolutely agree that there are times to rest and even to hide, and I think God provides that example in Elijah when God says, take a nap in that cave over there and eat some cake and take some more sleep, just hide for a while. While that's true, in this situation, for Hannah, it is so helpful to keep moving, to keep doing, to keep trying. So that's Hannah. If you're struggling with some aspect of motherhood, finances, or addiction, or whatever, maybe her story of bad news can unlock some good news for you. So number two, what do you do when someone else in your life feels desperate? What if you are Elkanah or you are Eli? Now, I'm not a mom, duh. I don't have any children. And because of who I am, I will never feel the desperation that she felt and that many of you have felt. I have my own issues of where I need meaning and where I need fulfillment and worthiness, but I will never understand how certain women feel when they can't get pregnant or when they face miscarriage or don't know how to meet that God-given calling to be a mother. I don't know that. But I do know what it's like to be around women who feel that. I'm afraid I know all too well what Elkanah was going through watching his wife melt to the ground. I know all too well as a man what it's like to be threatened by that pain. And you can discount all you want about my analysis of Hannah, and please come in and tell me from a woman's perspective what's going on in that text. I don't see. I'm sorry I'm not a woman preaching on Mother's Day. But when it comes to being the partner of a woman who wants children, or a pastor of women in all kinds of despair, I know all too well what it's like to be scared of that. I know all too well what it's like to think and say dumb things that are not helpful, to beat myself up when I misjudge, and to wish there was something I could do, anything I could do to change her or me or the world. Anyone love an alcoholic? You wish there was something you could do to change her or him? Anyone have a friend who just keeps making horrible decisions? Your parents are sick and you want to do something? You want so much to help, but over and over you say something insensitive, like Elkanah. You don't trust them enough, like Eli. You aren't fast enough to forgive, like Hansen. You don't have the patience. You don't fill in the blank. So what can we learn from these men's mistakes in the text? How do we support the Hannahs in our life better than we have? We'll start with verse 6. Check out verse 6. Her rival, Penaniah, used to provoke her. How do we support Hannahs? How about telling Penaniahs to shut their mouth? When I see parents being so overbearing on kids, there might be a different response than shut your mouth or something worse. But how do we stand up to that? Or on a bigger scale, when we see laws that taunt people who are already stigmatized, faith calls us to respond and to resist. When I see lawmakers malign immigrants or deny rights to gays or to take from the poor to give to the rich or try to explain away systematic racism or refuse to check their male privilege, which seems like a package deal these days, when I see that, my faith compels me to fight those Penaniahs to support Hannahs. Verse 8, and Elkanah said to her, look at what he said. Good questions, right? What's her response? Did he wait to listen to her answers? We can support the struggling people in our lives by listening to them more than Elkanah. And as valuable as listening can be, if you're going to say anything to the Hannahs that you love, how about that be encouraging? Hannah has enough self-lament and cultural criticism. She doesn't need our help with more. You might not agree with her analysis of her situation or her future, but acknowledge her feelings. You might not accept her decisions, but hold up her value as a person you love. Verse 13, Eli took her to be drunk. Listen, if I kicked out everyone in this church who is drunk, if I kicked out everyone in this church who I think they might be stoned or they might have some kind of problem, then during the week, it's just going to be me. Eli asks her, should have asked her what was wrong so he could find out how to help. He should have looked for something positive in the situation instead of assuming a negative. You remember Ray, who used to come here? She, right when I got here 5 years ago, she would sit over there, and then she left for a while, and she came back for a year or so. Ray, a few months ago, moved down south, and she taught me a new word before she left. I love learning new words. You all know the word paranoia, where you're just sure something is going to go wrong. Eli was paranoid about what was going on with Hannah. Ray told me she tries to live her life with pronoia. Pronoia is where you're always looking for what can go right in the world. Where is the good in that person? How can I align myself with the good in this situation? That speaks to me on a spiritual level. That sounds what Eli could have done and what we can do when faced with people in need. Final anecdote. Things happen here during the week when you're not here. Do you know that? There's meetings, more so there's just people who come in all the time. I met a Hannah this week. I meet a lot of people in need, and some of them are in crisis, and some of them are coming to the church in tears and desperation. This week, I met a mom who had wet eyes before she could introduce her three children. She described her situation on the road, stuck, camping up here. She had been brave enough to leave a violent situation, but she did not have time to plan it. So she grabbed her kids, she left her job as a nurse, she just headed west to get safe. And here she is, without much of a clue what to do next. How many women faces a culture where this is the norm? And have you ever heard someone say to you, I never thought this would happen to me. How many women face a culture that blames them for what happens to them and blames them for where they are now and still makes it hard for them to raise their kids alone? This Hannah is on the run from a man. She's protecting her children. She's strong. And how many people are going to judge her Why did you do that? You should have done this. Just get your stuff together. You can't care for them. What's wrong with you? So she came in here. I don't know if I was a good Eli, but I do know that someone in here brought some food, and we put it in that back cabinet, and I was able to give that food to her and her kids. So thank you for that. I don't know if I was very compassionate, but I do know that someone sent her here. She didn't just find this place on her own. Someone sent her here because you've made people feel welcome in the past. Thank you. I don't know if I really helped her much at all, but I do know I tried to listen. I tried to encourage her. I don't know what's going to happen to her. We got to end the story with Hannah. I don't know whether we'll ever hear from her again, whether she will get on her feet, how her kids will turn out, but I do know that her tears were a prayer and that her maternal instinct to care for those kids is going to keep going. I don't know what else to do for other women in that situation, but I know that we can pray for all mothers and all women who fall prey, P-R-E-Y, to cultural expectations, who are victims of male aggression, and victims of unreflective male privilege. We can pray for mothers who are struggling to care for kids and women in all those kinds of situations. Okay, I'm done. We're going to sing a song now. And I know that Kumbaya can be saccharine to any of you who grew up just singing it over and over around a campfire. But the song comes from people in desperate need. The song comes from people who are asking God, come by here now. I'm crying. Be here. I'm praying. Answer my prayer. I'm singing. Don't you hear me? So Eli thought Hannah was crazy because she prayed so hard. What she was saying with her tears was, come by here. And may we say the same ourselves.